This is just a short video today. It was originally going to be part of the Edfu Texts video that I will be releasing shortly, likely sometime in the next week. I decided that this content deserved its own dedicated video. Hopefully it will show you how important the relationship is between the Giza Complex, Göbekli Tepe, and my proposed location for Atlantis. The author Gary Osborne has pointed out to me that the distance between Göbekli Tepe and the Sphinx is exactly 1,000 times greater than the distance between the Sphinx and the westernmost Pyramid of the Queens. Here we can see how this Pyramid of the Queens relates to the rest of the Giza complex. Using Google Earth, I've decided to use the head of the Sphinx as my center point. My reasoning will become clear later. We can see here that the distance between the head of the Sphinx and the center of the westernmost Pyramid of the Queens is precisely 1,080 meters. Now, as Gary pointed out to me, the distance between the Sphinx and Göbekli Tepe at precisely 1,080 kilometers is exactly 1,000 times further, almost as if the Giza complex is pointing this out to us. Looking into this in a little more depth, I have found this interesting relationship. Drawing a line from the head of the Sphinx to the center of the largest structure in the complex, Khufu's pyramid, we can see that this line acts as a reflection point between the two vectors. Khufu's pyramid is an important monument as we know that it is built on a hillock, which is a natural hill or mound. We can also see that it is 1,080 meters from the center of the westernmost pyramid of the Queens to the center of Khufu's pyramid. Relative to geographic east, the vector also seems to show the slope angle of Khufu's pyramid at 51.84 degrees. We can connect the two locations with this great circle arc shown by the red line. If we head west from Göbekli Tepe all the way into the Atlantic Ocean, so long as we follow this line precisely, we make first landfall at the Dalabarata Reef in the Azores. The reef is now mostly submerged, with only the Formigas Hill sitting above the surface of the ocean. We have to remember that when Göbekli Tepe was built, at the very beginning of the Holocene, sea level was 60 meters lower than it is today. The Dalabarata Reef would have been an island at least 5 kilometers in length. It also would have been the easternmost island of the Azores archipelago. Now we need to do the same thing again, this time following the latitude of the Sphinx into the Atlantic Ocean. It's even more important to be precise with this line, as it passes very close to the Savage Islands. We now arrive at the Great Meteor Seamount. It's debatable regarding how much of this seamount might have been above water during either the last glacial maximum or the beginning of the Holocene. Most of the plateau sits at about 250 meters below sea level. Some of the bathymetric data I've seen suggests that the highest point, at the west of the seamount, sits only 85 meters below sea level. If this data is correct, then this would have been above sea level during the last glacial maximum and may have been just breaking through the surface at the start of the Holocene. 11,600 years of wave cutting could very well have further eroded this elevated part of the seamount. Engineer Michel Demaria has brought to my attention the 1424 Pisigano nautical chart. Although in the incorrect orientation, this map seems to show both the Azores and the Great Meteor Seamount in the correct location. Officially, the Azores was discovered in 1427 by Diogo de Silves. This was 3 years after the Pisigano nautical chart was drawn. Here, Michel has redrawn the 1424 chart with a more modern projection that we'd be familiar with today. This is still an early draft, and I know that Michel is working on improving the accuracy in future revisions. I have pointed to what appears to be the Great Meteor Sea Bank. Michel has also marked out at 52 degrees north, 15 degrees west, what might be High Brazil off the coast of Ireland, roughly in the location of the Porcupine Bank. What I've done here is drawn a line between the highest point of the Great Meteor Seamount and the highest point of the Dalabarata Reef. From here I've created an angle of precisely 90 degrees and headed due west. The line takes us all the way from the easternmost island of the Azores to the westernmost island of the Azores, Flores. I terminated the line at the highest point it crosses on the island, the peak of a ridge overlooking a valley. Now completing the triangle, we can see that this 1,080 kilometers crops up once more as the hypotenuse of this projection. It appears that the builders of Göbekli Tepe and the Sphinx were able to project this three-sided triangle from a simple line and two separate latitudes. Since drawing this triangle, Michel has informed me of a book he's reading, Sacred Number and the Lords of Time, The Stone Age Invention of Science and Religion by Richard Heath. In this book, the author expresses his opinions on how ancient builders probably didn't measure angles, but instead built triangles from squares, rectangles, and circles. We'll head back to the Azores in a moment, but first we have to go back to the Sphinx. Gary informed me that on the summer solstice, from the perspective of the Sphinx, the sun sets between the Khufu and Khafre pyramids. This is well known, but an additional detail added by Gary that is not so well known is that you can draw a great circle arc from the Sphinx to the Azores, using the azimuth of the sunset as your initial bearing. Using suncalc.org, I've calculated the azimuth we must follow. You can see here that the elevation is set to 0.86 degrees and not 0 degrees. This is because the head of the Sphinx sits approximately 34 meters below the horizon, which is over a kilometer away. I've added some additional height to the head based on overlays I've seen that suggest that the Sphinx was likely either a lion or an Anubis sculpture. After some trigonometry, I've arrived at a sensible elevation for the sun. Now I'm able to find the azimuth of 297.05 degrees. You'll see in a moment that it is likely no accident that the Sphinx sits below the horizon. It's also probably a good point to mention that Robert Schock's revised dating of the oldest parts of the Sphinx now stands at circa 10,000 years. This is in the ballpark of Göbekli Tepe. The orange line shows the Great Circle Arc starting at the Sphinx, heading west to the Azores. It's worth noting that this vector passes 400 meters from Manadra and 700 meters from Hagar Kim, both megalithic temple complexes found on the south coast of Malta. Before I continue any further, I will overlay the Woods Hole and Ifrema bathymetric data onto Google Earth so that we can get a clearer picture. Here we can see the Great Circle vector from the Sphinx passes through the Lost City, although not in the center. In theory, this line could continue around the world, so we need another vector that crosses its path, telling us where it terminates. We now have to travel back to Flores Island. We have to look from the ridge that overlooks the valley. Using suncalc.org once again, I have found the azimuth of 120.42 degrees to draw another Great Circle Arc, this time looking from Flores on the winter solstice sunrise. Miraculously, this also points directly to the Lost City, the point at which these lines cross triangulates the position of my proposed site for Atlantis. When we zoom in, we see it's not quite perfect, but it's good enough. Note the interesting ratios found here. The 1000 multiplier turns up once more. The distance to Flores is 1000 equatorial stadia in distance. Also, the distance to the Sphinx is precisely 30,000 polar stadia in distance. This is 50 degrees of the Earth's circumference, or a ratio of 10 over 72. If you want to check out Gary Osborne's work, he has his own website and he's authored and co-authored a number of books.